Well, good morning and welcome back. We're now going to do a quick start presentation on how to actually get your HPSDR software and hardware running. My assistant, the lovely Tom Holmes, N8ZM, will be handling the hardware and doing the installation. I'm John, N8UR, and Scotty, WA2DFI, is also going to be assisting because he helped build a lot of this stuff. This is not a highly scripted presentation today. It's a demonstration, so therefore, by definition, it will fail. But we're going to do our best to give you the steps that you need to get your Ozzy, Penelope, and Mercury board stack operating and ready to get on the air. So with that, these are the victims on the screen for today. The Atlas backplane, the Ozzy controller in the upper right, the Mercury receiver in the lower left, and the Penelope transmitter in the lower right. Those boards are installed in the enclosure. This is a prototype Pandora. It's not painted, but it's the same configuration as the production units. There's also an LPU power supply installed in the box. We're not going to take that out because we'd have to disassemble the whole enclosure in order to do that, and it would take a bit too much time. We're also not going to try to download the software packages off the internet today. They're very large, and with the limited bandwidth we have here in the hotel, that would take far too long. So we already have pre-installed the big packages. So the first thing that we need to do, and again, we're going to skip these elements, is install or download four software packages. You may already have at least the Microsoft Net on your computer, but you need Net 1.1 for PowerSDR. For several of the things that we are going to do and other applications, you also need Net 2.0. Again, you may already have these on your system if you've done a Microsoft update recently. So check in your installed programs. You may not need to go through this. If you do, URLs are on the slides. And by the way, the presentation materials will be available. We'll have this PowerPoint available for download. You will not be able to read, by the way, any of these URLs from the slides. I reduced the font so that they fit onto a single line to avoid the dreaded inserted line feed problem. So I had to go to very small fonts in order to fit them onto a single line. But if you get the presentation, you should be able to cut and paste those, and they'll work. So yeah, Microsoft URL memorized, right. So you download and install Net 1.1, Net 2.0. You may already have those. The second step is to download and install the Tortoise SVN software. This is free software. It's available from the SourceForge website. And Tortoise SVN is a Windows client for what's called a version control system. With this tool, you can automatically check for updates and download updates to the HPSDR software files and other applications as well. So we're going to install that first before we actually try to install the HPSDR software, because that's the tool that enables us to do that. The third thing that you need, if you want to update the firmware in your Merc or Penny card, and you do need to update the firmware, there have been significant changes since we originally released the hardware and the firmware that was loaded on them at manufacture, you need the Altera Quartus 2 programmer. That can be either a large download or a gigantic one, depending on which pieces you get. What you need is just the programmer tools that are about a 90 megabyte download. And you can go ahead and do that basic installation when you download it. Finally, there's a driver that's available from Flex Radio that is needed to communicate via the USB port with the Ozzy card. And we're going to download that now. We'll actually install that USB I/O driver a little bit later, but go ahead and download all those four packages. And my recommendation is that you just go ahead, get those four things downloaded. Make sure that you have them before you do anything else. Try to take it in sort of the steps of the most basic components and work our way up. Now, once you've installed Tortoise SVN, you will need to download the HPSDR software with that tool. So, Tom, why don't we switch over to your system, and why don't you create a couple of new directories? We can change the names because you already have the two that I'm recommending. And from your desktop, create a folder, then we'll right-click, enter the URL, and actually download, because these are not gigantic downloads. It shouldn't take too long to get them. We already have the software installed on Tom's machine, but the Tortoise SVN is so important, I think it's worth demonstrating how to get that set up. So, okay, after you've created the folder, actually close the window and just right-click on the folder that you've created. Go to the Tortoise SVN settings. And now enter the URL, which, Tom, you should be able to see to your left. It's a lengthy, painful thing to type in. Why don't you get connected, and I'll explain the process. What happens with Tortoise SVN is when you create a directory on your system that's going to be the place where the files are received. Then you tell the Tortoise software what the URL is to download the files from that directory. When you then do the update command, it goes out to that remote URL, checks the files there, compares them against what's in the directory, and if there's anything that's new or changed, downloads the new files. So you start with an empty directory. The first time you do the update, it downloads everything. But what's really cool is that if they update one file later, you come back and do the update, only that one file will have to be downloaded. So it's a way that you can automatically keep the software up to date without having to do a lot of full reinstallations. That's the method that we use for the HPSDR software, for the firmware packages that are available to update the hardware boards, and also for Phil Harmon's KISS console software that we'll hopefully be showing a little bit later, same method for downloading that code.
Okay. I should be connected.
Okay.
So I need to do now what?
Okay, there's the URL, which may actually be, whichever one it is we can use.
Looks like the right one.
Okay. Okay, you're in the repo now.
Yeah.
I think we need to go back and click on the update in the directory folder. Once this is set, you just right click on the SVN update in the right click menu on the folder itself, and
why don't you go to the folder you want to update?
This is the folder.
You can do it in Windows Explorer, and
just
it should.
Yeah.
Okay.
Open the window first.
Where do you want to go here?
Double click on
that.
Right.
And okay. Go up one level.
Now click on
there.
On the folder you were just in. Single click
and
now right click.
Right. Okay. And then. Since you've already got it, try the checkout. There we go. We already have the URL because we've done it before on this machine.
Been there, done that. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now click okay. There we are.
Having a wonderful time.
And we're adding all the files that are in the remote directory to our local directory. So as we watch, we're seeing those files be added, and it should tell us when it's finished.
And because we've already got a set downloaded, it's basically just adding
newer revs, right?
Okay. What's happening here is it knows about the existing version that we have on the machine. So it's, are these the new firmware for Penny and Ozzy that just came out last night? I can't quite read the file names that it's read.
2.8, yeah. 1.7.
What's happened is because we already have the files on the machine, it's putting the update into the existing directory and not, I think, into the new directory that we created. There it goes with the rest. No, it's getting the whole set.
It's putting them, yeah. Okay. See, it's doing them all because it's a new folder.
Yeah. Well, it looked like just those new ones first. And when this is finished, we'll click and do the same thing again, and we should see it's not doing anything else because it's comparing and determining that we already have the latest version of those files.
So we're done.
Yes. Yeah. Why don't we do the same thing again to show that it won't try again to download.
John, do you want to mention the fact that the green check mark on the directory says it's up to date?
Ah, yes. Well, yes, that's an important point, Bruce. Bruce mentioned that the check mark shows that it's up to date. That's true if it's automatically checking for updates, and there's a feature in Tortoise where it will go out and update or check all of the repositories to make sure they are up to date. It's been found out that can also cause significant drain on the resources of the computer. And there was just a couple of weeks ago a recommendation posted to turn that capability off if you don't have a very fast processor, because it can really bog the machine down. Well, once we're synchronized, we now have a local set of the files, and we can move on to the rest of the installation process. Now, if you're starting from a scratch machine, you would do this twice. We create the HPSDR version of PowerSDR. We'd also create another folder to hold the firmware. What we've just downloaded, I think, was the firmware directory. So you'll end up with two folders on your system. One is the HPSDR software. The other is the firmware. And just to clarify, the firmware that we're talking about is the firmware that gets uploaded into the FPGAs on the cards. So once you have the hardware, it can be updated by reprogramming the large square chips that are on the Penny and Merck boards. And we actually use the Ozzy board as the way to do that. The first step that we are going to do is, after we have the software on the machine, is install the driver that we need. On the first page, we downloaded a driver from the Flex Radio site that's called USB-IO. And that driver should be sitting in a folder on your system, Program Files, Flex Radio Systems, USB-IO driver. And you need to navigate to that location and double-click, and it will start a Windows installation routine. We already have that installed on this machine. One of the things that we've discovered is that sometimes when you try to install this driver, it installs and works, but when you come back after you've rebooted the system, it wants to reinstall it again. And we don't know quite why that happens. My theory is that it may be the result of trying to install the driver with the USB cable connected and Ozzy powered up, or possibly if you have the HPSDR executable running. So our recommendation is to get this USB-IO driver installed before you even hook the USB cable up or run PowerSDR. I think that's the best way to avoid that problem, which I suspect has something to do with some kind of file in use or locking problem if you try to install it with other things going on. So you basically will just double-click on that file in the Flex Radio Systems USB-IO driver folder and follow the steps to get that installed. Once you've done that, you actually now have done everything that you need to communicate between PowerSDR and the HPSDR system. However, as we already mentioned, the firmware that's on the boards that you have, if you got them from the factory, is now several steps out of date. And in fact, that firmware won't even work with the current version of PowerSDR. So you really need to go through the firmware update process first. There was actually just some new firmware that was released yesterday that we're going to try to download today and install to demonstrate how that happens. Doing that requires us to get the Ozzy turned into a programmer. And the next couple of steps that we're going to follow once we've installed the USB I/O driver is to configure things so that Ozzy can be a programmer for the other boards in the system. So Tom, what we're going to need to do now is remove all the other cards from the system so that we have only Ozzy installed on the motherboard. I'll get out of the way. You can also update the firmware using a programmer and a JTAG cable, but the designers were really clever in configuring the Ozzy board so that it can actually act as a programmer and avoids you having to go out and have that other piece of hardware to update the boards. And by the way, Ozzy's firmware itself is automatically updated when you run PowerSDR, so you don't need to update the Ozzy firmware, but the other boards, Penny and Mercury, and also Janus, if you were to be using that, all have updated firmware since the original manufacturer.
Now, at this point, does Ozzy need to be in any particular slot?
Not for this exercise. So we configure Ozzy so that he's the only card plugged into the board. The next step is to go to the HPSDR firmware folder and run a batch file there, which wakes things up, and then we'll have to install some drivers using the Windows driver mechanism. So in that, the folder that we've created that holds the HPSDR firmware, we find the usbblaster.bat file and execute that. Okay, now we have usbblaster.bat. We're just going to run that batch file.
And we basically are done.
And at this point, it is probably not going to ask us to reinstall because we have the drivers on this machine. If we didn't, it would prompt for the Altera USB drivers, and those can be found. Windows would ask us to install the drivers, and you point the Windows driver wizard to the Altera directory. The version that we're installing is version 9, Service Pack 2. So it's Altera 90SP2, Q Programmer Drivers, USB Blaster. Point there, follow the steps for the normal installation as you would any other driver. I think it may actually prompt you twice for two different drivers. And once you finish that, you now have the software loaded that will allow Ozzy to act as if it's a USB Blaster programmer. So at this point, you will need to swap some boards around, and we should have put the ESD warning up before we put Ozzy in, but you should be thinking about electrostatic discharge because you're going to be moving boards back and forth. Also, it's a very, very good idea to make sure you have the power turned off on the Atlas before you plug and unplug boards. I've probably pulled a board once or twice with the power on without having fried anything, but that's not really good shop practice. So let's power down the bus and get ready for programming. The programming process is the same for any of the boards that you're going to program using Ozzy. And this process is required by the architecture of the Atlas backplane and the design that the HPSDR boards use. You put the Ozzy card in slot 5 of the Atlas backplane. Slot 5 is the second slot from the end that has the power supply. The boards are the slots are numbered from left to right as you're looking at the back of Pandora, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So the largest number is on the left, and slot 1 is on the right. The Ozzy board goes in slot 5. The board that you're going to program goes in slot six, goes into the slot that's closest to the power supply. And that's required because of the way that the daisy chain for the JTAG programmer works. So we install the two cards, and on the card that you're programming, there's a jumper that's called last JTAG, and I think it may actually be abbreviated slightly differently on some of the different boards, but there's some kind of a two-pin jumper on the board that has a JTAG label. You need to have the jumper on that header for the programming to work. In theory, you should remove the jumper after you've programmed. What we found is that at least the way things work today, you can install that jumper once and leave it on. You won't have problems using the system in production afterwards, but someday that could change. So it's probably a good idea after you've programmed to remove the jumper. Okay, so we're going to install the Mercury board first into slot six. And power up the system. And then we will have to navigate back to our firmware folder. So in this case, we're going to go back onto the CD-ROM. And there will be batch files in the firmware folder for the board. There's a batch file that's named Program Mercury with some other characters behind it that identify the type of the FPGA. There's another one for Program Penelope. So you have to use some intuitive selection criteria to figure out which board you have plugged in and which batch file you want to run. But once you've made that correlation, you run the appropriate batch file, it will pop up a DOS window, and there are two or three questions that you need to answer, and then it will do the programming.
One thing you have to beware of is that when you install the Altera programmer, you use the default directory because all these batch files have that path hard-coded in them. So if you install the programmer in a different directory than what the Altera default is, you'll have to go and edit all these batch files. So it's probably best to just use the default.
Good suggestion. So once we have the batch file located, we just run double-click on that to run it.
This is Mercury EPCS16.
.bat?
.bat.
That's it. If you hear some Windows beeps, that's a good sign. It means that it's communicating with the OSI board. And
ones are good.
Yeah, it will prompt you for the version of the Quartus programmer that you have installed. If you have the latest version that's on the CD, that's option number four. So I'll enter four. Then it will look for all of the versions of the firmware that are available on your system. You'll almost always want to select the last number, but if for some reason the latest version causes a problem, you can go back to an earlier one by selecting a lower version number. So Tom selected the last version and hit return. And it will start running. Green text is good, red text is bad. It takes much longer to program Mercury than it does to program Penelope because the FPGA loads in the two boards are of different sizes.
Now, this programming process you're doing now, are you actually programming the FPGA or are you programming the boot flash?
We are programming the boot flash, but Scotty will answer knowingly.
Yes, that's what the EPS16 suffix is on that file, that batch file. That's the device that we're programming, which is the serial PROM, that then will load the FPGA when you power it back up.
And the same was true with OSI?
The same is true with OSI for the programmer software, but OSI normally on normal operation gets loaded via the software. So the actually operating code in OSI is in the PowerSDR directory.
Now, we got a successful completion message in the batch window, so we now have updated the board. And Tom, we don't need to update the other board, but we can go ahead and reinstall the boards in a minute. But let's take Alan's question first.
Can we find those instructions you've laid out so nicely on the slide? Can we find those somewhere?
We are going to make that available as quickly as we can at the location that the other DCC presentations are. I should point out, there is on the HPSDR wiki a quick start guide currently there. Virtually everything in here is cribbed from that. We changed the order a little bit. Our feeling was that the order of presentation in the wiki guide had you doing the firmware updates later than some of the other steps. And so it's a little bit more logical progression. We've included the actual URLs rather than links. So it's a standalone, but all the information here is basically the information that was available in the Wiki Quick Start. We will make this available as well. So having successfully programmed the firmware, you would repeat that for any of the other boards that you have that require updates. At this point, both Mercury and Penelope require updates from the factory load. If you're using Janus, the sound card, that also has had updates. And again, Ozzy's firmware automatically updates if you get a new version of the PowerSDR that's been configured for HPSDR. That will have the Ozzy firmware as part of that directory. So Ozzy takes care of itself. So once we're finished with that, now it's time to actually put the box together. So once again, we power things down and we plug in the cards. Now, early on, there were some real issues with the clock timing on the Atlas bus. And if you did not have the cards in some magic slot order, things didn't tend to work. Of course, the magic order seemed to be different for different people. But today, there should be no dependency on the card order. You can put the cards in any slot that you want. However, the conservative practice would be to do it the way that seemed to work best before, which was to have Ozzy in slot number 2, second slot from the right if you're looking at the back of at the Pandora open end, and to put Penny and Mercury in slots 3 and 4 so that they're adjacent to each other but one slot away from Ozzy. If you have Roger W3SZ's backplane, you'll note he has a different order, and he has the boards adjacent to one another, and that seems to work fine. Again, the current code should eliminate all of those location dependencies. Except for the programming step of requiring slots 5 and 6. So Tom's now installed the three cards into... You have them adjacent to each other, but which should work. And having done that, we now have a radio. We can hook up the USB and the power with luck. You'll hear the happy chime from Windows that tells you that it detected the new device. If you're even luckier, it won't ask you to reinstall the USB I/O driver. And we seem to have succeeded in that. And we're now ready to run HPSDR. That's our outside antenna. You're going to put that on the receiver? Okay. For today's demo, we have an antenna, courtesy of Bill Diaz, outside. And we actually might be able to hear something. This building is an extraordinarily good Faraday cage. And with the rubber duck antenna, we were able to hear, is it WBBM that's 50 kilowatts about 2 miles from here? We could sort of hear it, maybe about minus 90 dBm. So we're hoping that we'll hear a little bit more today with an outside antenna. So Tom will now navigate into the HPSDR folder and just click on PowerSDR. Okay, the first time that you run PowerSDR, just as with the Flex Radio version, there's a one-time optimization that's going through to figure out how fast your computer is and the best way to configure the FFT library that it uses for a number of the functions within PowerSDR. So that takes a minute or two to operate. So we're watching on the screen now. It's just telling us that's going to happen. It's now finished. We can click through. And Power SDR should be coming up, and it does.
Timing is everything.
Now, this is a version of Power SDR that Bill Tracy, KD5, I hope I get this right, TFD, has patched the code into to support the HPSDR boards. Unfortunately, because the HPSD or the Flex Radio version of the software has been moving so quickly, it's not really synced up with the current Flex version. Flex is now shipping or supporting, I think it's version 1.18.3. This is based on version 1.10. So a few of the things that have been added lately to the Flex version of Power SDR aren't yet supported here, but it still is a fully functional, very usable piece of software. And the plan is to re-merge the software when I think the next major release of Power SDR comes out later this year. There'll be a resynchronization of bringing the HPSDR version up to it. So we get this cute warning that we might kill ourselves if we use this software. There's a very simple power setup wizard that we click through. This is all the first time. We select the HPSDR software. We select the boards that we have installed, which at this point is, it assumes that you have OSI, because if you don't, you don't have power HPSDR, so you select Mercury Penelope. It's wishful in thinking that you might have Alex. We all wish we had Alex. And then it's finished. Now, before you turn the radio on, you may want to give a little bit of thought to whether your processor is fast enough to support the full sample rate and the default buffers. Tom's running this demonstration on, I think it's a 1.2 gig Pentium M, which is a fairly marginal processor. It does work, but before we start the radio, we're going to be better off if we make a few changes. So we'll go into the Setup tab, the Audio.
Well, I got to just follow the bouncing ball.
Yep.
Yeah. All right.
Set the sample rate from 192 down to 48. And that should be enough to get us going for now without making any other. We can also reduce the size of the other buffer, but at 48K, I think we should be okay.
It's only if you have a main computer.
Yeah. Yeah, so if you have a faster processor, the defaults should work just fine. Having done that, we should be able to hit the start button and make it work. When you hit the start button, you'll get a DOS box up, and what's happening is it's installing, uploading the firmware into OSI and turning everything on. Now, you'll notice a minor problem. The noise floor is about minus 20 dBm. That's not true. The radio does need to have a level calibration done. If you have a signal source at a known amplitude, you basically plug that in, tell the radio what the frequency and the amplitude of that source is, and it will then calibrate, and you'll end up with an extremely accurate signal level indicator. We don't have that here today, so a way to cheat is to go to the general calibration. And over here in the level calibration, instead of minus 70, enter minus 130 and hit start. And we're just going to calibrate against the noise.
Except he has the antenna connected.
Okay. Yeah, well, we can redo it. Yes, disconnect the antenna before you do this. This will not give you an accurate amplitude reading in the pan adapter or on the S meter, but it will give you something that at least isn't grotesquely wrong. And the recommendation is to find a signal source. The Elecraft, I forget the model number, but they make an inexpensive 20 meter signal source that works perfectly for this. It's accurate within a couple of dB. SG-1 Elecraft, or any kind of a signal generator that has a calibrated output level should let you do the calibration. You can also calibrate the frequency. We won't worry about that today. It's going to be within probably a few hundred hertz, but there is the ability to fine-tune the frequency in software and calibrate that against a known reference frequency. So,
and just to prove it's working, this is with the antenna unplugged.
Ah.
So we're getting something. I don't know where it's coming from.
Okay. We now have a working radio. So, Tom, why don't you just tune around and play a little bit?
WWB, right?
Yeah.
Or, can you guys all hear that?
Yeah. That could be WWV in the middle, or it could be a spur. This software at this point is working just the same as it would with a flex radio, either an SDR-1000 or a 5000. You can right-click, and then you get the cursors. You left-click, and that's the frequency that you're tuned to. You select the filters over here, the mode over here. You can tune up here. Noise blanker, noise reduction, all available here. Mic gain and compression settings, all here. So it's... So here's 780 AM. Is that WLS or WBBM? WBBM? So at this point, we're operating this very much as we would if it were a flex radio system, and you have a working radio. And with that, we're going to take any questions that you might have. And then for the time that we have available, Tom has brought along a couple of his very inexpensive toys. And we're going to switch gears a little bit and talk a little bit about what RF signals look like on the air. We have a spectrum analyzer that we can put onto the video screen. And we're going to take a look, hopefully, at what PSK31 looks like also. What some of the digital voice modes look like. Tom, why don't you take over the driver's wheel?
Yeah, give me just a minute. Get set up here. I have to learn how to use Larry Wolfgang's new PSK box. I also have to learn how to plug it in.
And while we're waiting, we have another SDR station running over on the left table. And that has been configured, thanks to Mel, with some digital voice software. And we'll be able to transmit from that and hopefully receive it over here look at the digital voice. Power SDR doesn't include digital voice modes, or actually any digital mode modulation or demodulation as part of the package itself. But there are software programs available that allow you to link to another application to provide any of the digital modes, and we have I'm going to get the initials wrong, FDMDR digital voice software running on the other machine via that means.
Okay. I don't think that's me. I don't know if you can hear that. You probably can't hear that or not. But you can see it. Somebody playing... doing a little ready, so we're actually hearing something in here. Now, all I'm using for a transmit antenna is a rather short little whip here.
Yeah. Larry points out it's the RIDI contest this weekend, so there is likely to be some of that stuff around.
Yeah, a little CQ stuff. But I'm going to be rude. Okay, that's the transmit. There's the spectrum analyzer. Tuned to the same frequency. Let me shut it down. So you can see we are actually seeing a signal RF-wise. Now that's going from this little whip to another random length of wire I've got just hanging off the front of the spec end. But just to give you some idea, now this is new PSK box that, as you recall, Larry just built on Thursday, or maybe it was Friday. He told us about building it on Friday. If I tighten the span up a little bit. And
bring it back to the center where it belongs. We're still looking at, for PSK 31, they only use like a 31 hertz shift, and if you look in the lower left corner, you see I've got a 47 hertz filter, so obviously I can't separate things real well yet. Now I can. I probably got a signal level issue. Or I'm overdriving. Probably overdriving something. You probably recall Steve Ford wrote an article not too long ago about that. That didn't help either. But anyway, so you can see that that's what a PSK 31 signal looks like. Now, where the exciting part of the, let me turn the mic gain down completely. I'm still getting. So I'm not exactly sure where that is coming from. It may be. Oh, wait a minute. I got a pod. I got 17 adjustments. All of them inappropriate. They're starting to come back up.
Tom, you might, on Power SDR in the middle left, turn the drive level from, if it's at 100, back the transmit drive down.
This?
No. Yeah. Oh, we're already very, very
I'm
low.
All really
yeah, never
pretty
mind.
Low, yeah. One of the nice things is that when you find these sliders, you get a message a little bit about what to expect it to do in case the name attached is not particularly convincing. What about this gate, John? Would that have anything to do with it?
That would be blocking this the audio if below okay. A given level. That's turned off. You should be okay.
And then tried to transmit equalization.
What happens if you increase the gain a little bit?
Mic gain?
Yeah.
It brings everything up.
Yeah, including the noise.
Yeah, but it also on the spec end, all of these things are running together. I mean, all of the, so it's almost like it's in the audio going into the box. Does that make sense?
There's a TX audio pot.
Yeah,
there.
I played with that too. I'm sorry?
Is that in the AM transmit profile?
Yeah.
Let me.
Yeah, you know what? I wonder. You're.
Did you?
Yeah, it looks a little better. I think. Maybe not. Well, as I recall from the other night, it always had some amount of that in there. So I don't know if there's a distortion product somewhere.
One thing that's misleading, when you look at Power SDR in transmit mode, it looks like there's this really high noise floor in the pan adapter window. But when you look at the peak against the noise floor, you've got 30 or 40 or more dB. So there's actually a pretty good signal to noise. You're just seeing that noise floor because of the logarithmic scale. It doesn't sound as noisy as that might look on the air.
Mm-hmm. This is wire.
Try narrowing the transmit filter. Just take your mouse and just get it right on the edge. You know, right on the edge. Now bring it in. There you go. Bring it in. On both sides until you have that signal right in the center. Go to transmit.
Go to transmit.
Go to transmit. And now bring it in.
Oh, you're saying this is all I really need to have. Aha.
There you go. Now maybe it'll clean it up.
Now I got to probably get a little tighter with it because... Yeah, I got to get real tight. And that, it still hasn't, it hasn't changed the spec in any. Yeah, for some reason, this one has typically been reading that way. I think we've got a calibration thing to do there. Yeah, no matter what I do, it's still hanging in here. I suspect it's a level issue. But I don't know what the level... It never... Actually, in the other night, it wasn't really all that clean either. But that's just... That's a little dirtier than what we had before. So I'm not sure what... There might be some other setup thing going on here. But the point is that we are basically able to transmit something and see what it is. And where did I hide the microphone? I'm going to replace... Crunch. Going to replace... that with a microphone. And do a few other things. You do have to remember to shift gears on this. Okay. Okay, obviously I need to deal with this problem too.
Switch over to your screen so they can see what you do.
Oh, okay. There, I'm going to set it back up to SDR. So I put it back in sideband. I'm going to set this for about there. We could turn on some equalization. It turns on the compander automatically. I think we were okay. So now if I key it and I talk, you can see something that resembles me talking. That's what the output from, that's what the, SDR thinks it's doing, and this is what the spectrum analyzer thinks I'm doing. So there's at least something in my, in the way of my voice is actually making it out to the antenna. So now that we've got essentially SDR up and running, we've established that we can hear and we can transmit. A lot of the rest of it here is not entirely my forte, but you can see all the various choices. Thanks, Scotty. You can see the various choices of things that you can mess with, one of which is the display. There's a spectrum display that you can get.
The spectrum display is showing you only what's in the width of your receive filter. The pan adapter is showing you the full sweep of the sampling rate, with the green part being your current receive filter.
There's also an oscilloscope mode, so you could see the time record. Let me... Let me toggle it. You can see, okay, there you can see me talking there, okay. Then there's some phase things and waterfall and a histogram. Since we don't really have a signal, you know, if we had signals, we'd see things popping up out of here, of course. The waterfall should eventually. Now, this one, I've always had trouble getting this to work, but somebody had it working last night. What were they doing different? You should see a similar thing to the histogram. In other words, but like you're looking down on the signal from the top. Oh.
Yeah. There's also a sensitivity setting for where the black starts changing color on weak signals.
Okay.
Which, with the very weak signals that we have here.
We may not be getting past the threshold. Yeah. Probably if I were to go back to AM.
From a new place.
There you can see it. So you see here in the center, this is the station with the sidebands. Now, is that the IBOC station? Okay. Yeah, that... Yeah, now you can see one of the two IBOC sidebands. If you're familiar with the whole digital broadcast thing, they've got a set of subcarriers here and another setup over here. And probably I need to give myself a little more room.
These are the top stories on News Radio 780 WBBM. Film director Roman Polanski faces extra...
Well, that's nice. Now, one of the cool things about this, that tuned in the radio, and I happened to use this for the VHF contest a few weeks ago. We used this on 6 meters. And basically, the thing I like is you right-click and you get these cursors and you can dial around. If you want to retune the radio, you see a signal somewhere you want to look at. Okay, you just do that, and now I'm tuned to it. And so as fast as you could click, that thing would snap in, and you'd be hearing that guy talking. And so when it comes to, you know, finding activity on the band, finding stations, it really was a time saver. And most of the time, if you caught the lower edge right about there, you would tune it in on a sideband signal well enough that there was very little fine-tuning required. Now, the other aspect of that is that I've got a wheel on the mouse, so I can roll the mouse wheel and fine-tune it if I need to.
And because we're running at 48,000 samples, we're seeing a displayed bandwidth in the scope of about 45 kilohertz. Remember that we can go up to 192 kilosamples, so with a faster processor, we'd be able to look at about 180 or so kilohertz simultaneously and do that right-click to get the cursor tuned and immediately move any signal in that pass in that span into our passband.
Now, okay, over here, okay, are the different bands, and you guys are probably used to this kind of stuff, but one of the features that HPSDR offers is you can use this with a transverter. So if you had a transverter that down converts to 10 meters, the Mercury card would tune itself to the 10 meters, and your transverter would be wherever it is on 2 or 1296 or 10 gig. And it would take care, you'd tell it the LO, and it would take care of the frequency conversion, so the thing would read out in the real frequency and so on. And you can actually set up multiple transverters for that if you want. You can also... QSY directly to WWV, pick one. And you see, if I just keep clicking it, it steps up through them until I run out. Now, the 10 meg reference for this may be a little off. I'm going to assume WWV is more right than we are. Now, I have no idea what that signal is, so let me turn the volume up here. And you notice that when I told the thing to tune off to a different frequency, it immediately went back to general coverage. Yeah, I don't think we're getting much in here today. So now there's also a preamp we could play with. Noticeably.
Tom, I just turned the other station on digital voice on 14170. I don't know if you'll be able to receive it over there, hopefully. And this system is now transmitting with the FM DR FDMDV digital voice software. I think we learned last night that's something like 18 closely spaced carriers within an audio SSB bandwidth doing digital voice. And we're just going into the world's least efficient rubber duck over here on 20 meters, so there's not a whole lot of signal getting out, but hopefully we can see
it. Yeah, but there it is right there. You can tell by the square characteristic to it and the relatively constant amplitude that that's a digital signal of some sort.
Talk here. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Yeah. One of the cool things about digital voice is that when you look at the transmitted signal, it probably doesn't change much whether it's modulated or not. you'll see a little bit, but in general, it just looks like a stepped up increase in the noise floor. And if I turn the volume up.
A good suggestion to put the display in waterfall mode.
Okay, yeah. So there's that. And just to show you what happens if I move, okay. So you can hear something in there. Now if we go to waterfall. Yeah, we have to let this other stuff clear out. So now over here is the digital signal. So now it's basically focused in more, but it still is not centered, and I don't understand why, you know, the selected frequency. Well, I guess maybe it is because there's the... No, maybe not.
Yeah, we don't have the software developers here today, but the question came up earlier. I think what's going on is that the bandpass that's being downsampled and sent on the USB is a fixed chunk of 48 kilohertz, and as you tune, that doesn't move synchronously, so what the signal that you're actually tuned to may not be centered in the band of what's being sent down into the computer, so you can't always center the bandpass directly in the middle of the PAN adapter display.
Okay. Okay, we figured out how to do it. If we grab the number scale at the top, which is essentially the frequency, you can see how we can... And that'll blow it out even further. Now what you can start to see is because the DRM stuff is essentially a lot of carriers, each transmitting QPSK at like a 50 baud rate, there's like 14 carriers. Now you can start to see the individual carriers within the transmitted signal. And the little trick we were playing last night, we actually took the SPECAN and dialed it down to just wide enough to look at one carrier and then put it in digital DMOD mode, and we could actually see the QPSK bit constellation and the like coming off of it. Just to validate that they were doing what they said they were. Now, this might work a little better.
I think they cheated you out of three carriers.
Your eyesight's better than mine, Bruce. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Now, they're there. There's actually, you'll actually see 15 lines across there if you get out your magnifying glass, because in the middle is a little two-tone BPSK pilot signal, and that sends essentially the reference rate to the receiver, so it's got something to lock in on, and then it can get synchronized with all of the other subcarriers and actually do some useful DMOD.
Is there any software that works with this system that doesn't require Windows?
The answer is sort of. There have been a couple of people who've developed Linux-based consoles. None of them are as finished or polished as the Flex Radio, the PowerSDR. The current version of PowerSDR is Windows only. There is a complete system rewrite that's been going on for some time that will be platform independent when it is finished, and that will run Linux, Mac, Windows. And in fact, the way that system is designed, you'll be able to run the DSP functions on one system and the display on another, and they're isolated so you can talk to them over a LAN or any other intercommunication, and it's a very modular virtual radio design. I'm not sure when we're going to see that, probably sometime next year. So
is that still written in C-sharp, or is it in something more conventional for the other platform?
The new system is in a combination of there's a language called Erlang that's being used for the high level interconnect, and I think then the individual pieces are can be written in different languages.
I see. So is Frank?
I'm not really deeply familiar with it, other than that it's complicated and cool.
Just to follow up, what is available today that doesn't, in other words, even if it's not as good as Flex or Power SDR, what might be available today?
Well, actually, I'm well, it's still a Windows application. There's another program called the KISS console that's written in C# that we're not going to have time to demonstrate today, but is available. This is really the operating software for the HP SDR system as of right now. There really isn't another fully functional alternative. There is a Linux Java-based console, and you'll find references to it on the wiki, but I don't know if it's really being used by anybody on a day-to-day basis or is still more of an experimental platform. And I don't mean to run it down because I'm not haven't personally used it, so I don't want to be negative about it, but no one seems to be using it on a day-to-day basis. This seems to be the software that all the people who are doing the hardware development and the integration are using the Flex, the Power SDR software at this time.
Pretty much, I think that's what I've got. You've pretty well seen what this can do and how it does it. And all in all, it wasn't all that difficult to get it up and running. You know, I've had my cards for, you know, ever since they came out, and I'm just now this weekend finally got around to messing with it. And, you know, I was a little intimidated by the whole process just because I hadn't really thought it through or looked into it. But John had only been through it maybe once or twice. And so we got our heads together Saturday or Friday night and made it work. We only had a couple of little snags that we needed help from Scotty on, and it all went pretty smoothly. So that's basically our story, and we're sticking to it. So thank you much. And you're welcome to come over here and poke around a little.